I'm Dr. Adam Rutherford.
And I'm Dr. Hannah Fry.
And you are going to send us your everyday mysteries.
And we are going to investigate them.
Using the power of...
science!
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 I like it. Hello, curios! Series 9!
Whoop whoop!
Yes, it deserves two whoops.
Like a train noise.
How are you, Dr. Fry?
I'm absolutely delighted to have made it to Series 9. I'll tell you that for free.
I know. And then we're starting with a massive bang as well, a two-parter on
are
sex.
Are you trying to pun already?
I don't know what you're talking about. The question came from a curio from Leeds, Robert. And we'll get to the specifics of the question in the programme itself, but there's an additional which we didn't quite get in there.
Yes, he said, I am an avid science fiction reader and there have been many attempts to describe aliens with multiple genders. But do we have any evidence to support this actually working? Now, this is a mistake that I made actually a few times during the interviews of this programme. Gender and sex are different things and we're talking about sex.
We are specifically talking about sex.
Genetic stuff.
How males and females and other types of sexes might already exist in nature.
And as you can imagine, dear listeners, I have had a long day of telling Adam that he cannot put puns into this programme. I think, well, a couple slipped in. Now, we know that we have a lot of family listeners, of parents who listen together with their children to this programme. And we thought about, you know, having maybe a parental warning on this. But actually, I think that there's nothing in this programme that you wouldn't find in a textbook, a biology lesson at school, one of those, you know, slightly awkward ones, let's be honest, but nothing beyond that.
Is that your warning?
No, that's me talking to you.
No, I agree. I agree. Well, you know, in many ways, the study of evolution, the study of genetics, is trying to understand how reproduction works and how inheritance works. And those two things are facilitated in most animals by sex. So we're going to be talking about some of the fundamentals of biological reproduction in the next 15 minutes or so. So brace yourself, strap on in, let's crack on. For today's curious case, we thought we'd investigate one of the biggest, trickiest mysteries in the whole of biology.
Which is exactly what 12-minute lunchtime radio programmes were built for.
Exactly. Robert Turner from Leeds sent this question into curiouscases@bbc.co.uk.
Why do we only have two sexes? Are there any anomalies in the animal kingdom? Okay, what's so tricky about this, Adam? Boy meets girl, egg, sperm, babies.
Well, that's how we do it. But there's a whole carnival of sexual practices out there in nature, so much so that we've devoted the next two episodes to the ins and outs of sex in nature.
And where better to start than London Zoo? I've come here to meet an incredible creature.
Fan system with a
not boiler. Him. That's herpetologist Chris Michaels. Although he is perfectly nice. Instead, we're on our way to meet his star attraction.
No, Galaxy's out and about. You can see him there at the back
gosh,
of the enclosure.
It's huge.
Okay, so yeah, just to our right here, we have Ganas, the Komodo dragon, which is a huge type of monitor lizard.
He is a magnificent beast. Mm. Can we go in the enclosure then?
How attached are you to your limbs?
Generally, I quite like them, I'll be honest.
Okay. I would say on this side.
Would he actually take off a limb?
They've got a huge number of extremely sharp, sort of sickle-shaped, serrated teeth, which each one is like a sort of knife, so he would do a lot of damage. And of course, they've got a venom, which reduces the ability of wounds to heal and increases the chance of infection. So it's not to be recommended.
I think on balance, let's stay here.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, I understand there's something quite special about Gamnas.
Yes, he's a parthenogen, which means that he has no father and his mother created him all alone.
She spontaneously became pregnant with him.
She did. It's something that Komodo dragons occasionally do, as well as some other monitor lizards and some other vertebrates. So you end up with a male dragon which has got normal sets of chromosomes, but they're all from the mother.
Does that mean that they could just do away with the males altogether and just all the females end up having offspring themselves?
For one generation. So if you've got a lone female who does happen to parthenogenetically reproduce, she can produce loads of males, which, being males, can't then produce further parthenogens. So the only way it can work is if there was only one female dragon left in the world and she produced parthenogenic animals, they would have to mate with their own mother for the species to continue.
See, I told you weird things happen in nature. So they haven't done away with men completely.
No, not yet. This is called parthenogenesis, which is literally a virgin birth. But they only do it very, very rarely, and it only produces male offspring.
Well, that is Komodo dragons, but there are some animals who have managed to do away with sex entirely, such as the tiny creatures called Deloid rotifers. Chris Wilson from Imperial College London introduced me to one for the very first time down the microscope.
I've found you a single rotifer. They are less than half a millimetre long. It's about the smallest thing we can possibly see with the naked eye, and we can only then see it if you hold it up to the light as a tiny white dot.
Oh, hello. Oh, God, she's moving all over the place. God, how do you describe this tiny little wormy-like thing with a sort of fat body? She's ridiculously cute. I know all biologists like their particular organisms that they work on, but that is undeniably a cute, tiny, tiny organism.
I think so. And the name, too, of this species is especially cute. So she's called Philodina, which means I love to spin. And that's how they get around. They turn their wheels, they lift up their foot, and they will spin around in spiral patterns through the water.
Now, where do we find them? Describe their sort of lifestyle.
They live anywhere where you have fresh water, even if it's only temporary or a tiny amount. So while walking over here, I grabbed some patches of moss from walls, and this moss will be full of Deloid rotifers. All you need to do is add a little bit of water, and they will pop to life and start feeding and laying eggs. And all of them that have ever been examined are female. And that one's just proven her credentials because she has an egg right next to her.
Yes.
And another one developing inside her ovary.
Okay, so top right in the microscope field is a little sort of rugby-shaped ball. That's the egg, is it?
That's exactly right. She is going to sit there spinning the wheels that are on top of her head and pulling in food, and she's going to be turning that into more eggs.
Okay, now they're all female, and they're asexual. They reproduce. This one that we're looking at right now will just squeeze out an egg which is genetically identical to her mother.
It's one of the simplest processes one could imagine. We just create exact copies of the mother, and all the daughters are the same as each other and the same as their mother. It's exactly twice as efficient as producing males and females, because we skip all of the wasted energy that you would otherwise put into male offspring, and we get 100% conversion rate from food into female offspring, and those female offspring convert all of their energy into more eggs. And when everyone can lay eggs, the efficiency is twice as much as when you have males that can't lay eggs.
Wasted energy that you put into male offspring. Wow, that's harsh.
Yep, there's no room for snowflakes in biology. But this really is a genuine problem for geneticists. Why does sex exist at all?
Well, Adam, of course, if you want a problem solved, you need to turn to mathematics. In the 1970s, sex became mathematical. The late great John Maynard Smith applied game theory to evolution and concluded that the existence of men just doesn't add up. Making males wastes 50% of a living creature's resources because they can't produce offspring. A population that ditched men would grow at twice the rate. And from an evolutionary standpoint, this should be a win-win situation, according to geneticist Aoife McClissett from Trinity College Dublin.
In terms of evolution, the way to succeed is to pass on your genes and to pass them on very effectively through all the generations. And when we think about sexual reproduction, what we're doing is we're passing on half of our genes to our children who have half their genes from somebody else. And we're putting a lot of effort into this. And so it appears on the face of it to be inefficient. And it's one of these things that's considered pretty much a mystery in terms of biology and evolution. So the enigma of sex, it's sometimes called, because what we see is that throughout life, all different kinds of organisms have sex. So they all have sexual reproduction and it's occurring everywhere. So that leads us to say, well, there has to be a good explanation.
Which is?
Don't know.
What do you mean you don't know?
We don't know. We don't know what the explanation is.
Biologists.
Well, look, sex isn't very efficient, but it is everywhere, and we're not really sure why. We do have some clues, though, because there's a pretty large hole in the asexual armoury. Let's go back to Chris Wilson and his super cute spinning rotifers, although this one's not looking quite so cheery. Am I looking at a dead one now?
That's right. So there's not much movement going on in there,
no,
I think.
There isn't. She's pretty stationary.
That's right. So she would have eaten the wrong kind of spore, and it germinated inside her and broke down her tissue, and she's now deceased.
She is an ex-Rutherford.
That's right.
Of course. So what's the problem? How do we connect up asexual reproduction with an ex-Rutherford like the one we're looking at?
So one of the drawbacks of asexuality is that because everyone's the same, everyone has the same vulnerabilities, particularly to diseases. Once one animal in this population gets infected with a disease like this fungus, it will very quickly spread to all of her daughters and sisters and female relatives because they're all genetically the same. And so we have epidemics that can very quickly wipe out not just a single Rutherford, but all of the Rutherfords with that genetic combination in the whole population.
And that's the fundamental problem with asexual reproduction, isn't it?
It's certainly one of the big ones, yes.
So how do they get around it?
In the case of this fungal disease, the Rutherfords have a special trick. When the population starts to become overwhelmed with fungus, they can lose all the water in their bodies. Even better, once the water is gone, they can blow around like little particles of dust on the wind and move to a new area, a new patch of moss or a new puddle, and pop back to life, and the fungus can't follow them. And so they have a trick to escape from this particular disease in space and in time.
They have to dehydrate themselves to outlive the fungus.
Yes, dehydration is not a tactic that many creatures enjoy, but it does work for the Rutherfords. They are pretty unique. Rutherfords have been around for about 50 million years or more, but most other asexual creatures are relatively recent, last few hundred thousand years, and they don't tend to last very long.
Because they're wiped out by diseases.
Right, so we males do have our uses after all.
And it turns out sex has advantages too.
These are sometimes summarised as the good, the bad and the ugly. So the disadvantage of cloning yourself is that it gives rise to a population that are genetically homogenous. So they're all genetically identical. So they're all equally strong, but they're all also equally weak. Whatever weaknesses one of them has, they all have. And that's kind of where the ugly comes in the good, the bad and the ugly.
OK, so how about the other two then, the good and the bad?
Well, so if I was to clone myself now, then the offspring would have everything I have, including any little negative things I might have. And one thing we know about the way DNA changes over time is that each of us carries about 60 new mutations that are totally new to us that isn't inherited from our parents. So this clone, my clone, would have a few new mutations as well. And the chances are that those mutations either do nothing or make things worse, because in terms of our DNA, it's much easier to break it than to make it better. So you'd be kind of on a one-way track to degradation. There's no way to kick out that bad stuff. So when we're talking about sex and we're talking about sexual reproduction, what we're talking about is this combination of DNA from two different individuals. And because it's not 100% of the DNA, some of it's getting left behind. And that just means there's a chance if you can put two different good genes together and be even better than before. And there's a chance for the bad stuff to be left out.
So, Dr. Rutherford, when it comes to why we only have two sexes, can we say case solved?
Not yet, Dr. Fry, but we can say that two sexes are sometimes better than one.
Mixing our genes means we're more resistant to parasites and diseases.
Plus, there's a chance to shuffle out some of the bad stuff and shuffle in some better genes.
But why don't we have more than two sexes?
Well, that is the question for our next episode. See you then. Okay, I won't lie. This is one of my favourite subjects of all across all of the sciences, even within evolutionary biology. This is like my dream question.
It's super, super fascinating. I mean, there's just so many different creatures that we have uncovered the story, or I hadn't heard them before, that Adam has told us and lots of the contributors have told us, that it's just mind-blowing. Like, the range of diversity in the way that animals reproduce is just absolutely extraordinary.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, the fact that sex exists is still a bit of a mystery. We're going to talk about it a bit more in the second podcast, which will be coming up in next week.
But while we were talking to all those expert contributors, there were a couple of extra stories that we wanted to fit in, including this one here, which comes from Chris Michaels, the herpetologist, the reptile keeper at London Zoo. And he told me about an astonishing and very cunning, sneaky trick that is used by salamanders that you find in the Great Lakes of North America. But before we get to that, first off, you need to know a little bit about salamander sex.
Well, male salamanders will court anything that moves. Once they've mated, the male sort of does a little dance, entices the female, and then he drops a spermatophore, which is like a sperm plug. It's like a little jelly pyramid with a package of sperm on the top, and the female then picks that up with her vent, and then there's internal fertilisation.
So far, so normal. Boy salamander meets girl salamander, does a little dance, and they make babies.
Yes, but then along comes another species, the blue-spotted salamander. Now, these blue-spotted salamanders, they live in all female populations. They have got rid of males altogether, and the way they've done this is pretty sneaky. They do it by stealing sperm from other species.
They take the sperm, they throw away the genetic material, so the reason the male got involved in the first place, and they just use the machinery of the sperm to stimulate their own eggs to start acting. And that means that you've got these lines of clonal females that just basically con the male out of his time, effort and sperm and just reproduce themselves.
Let me make sure that I've understood then. These female blue-spotted salamanders nick their sperm, chuck out all of the genetic material, mm-hmm. and use that to fertilise their own eggs.
Yeah, exactly. They're con artists. So they either throw it away straight away or they throw it away when their offspring breed. It basically means that males are not quite redundant because the housing for their genetic material is required. So they have to be there, but they don't have to be the same species.
I've never heard that one before. I've never come across the sperm-stealing salamanders.
I'm going to make that my new dinner party chat.
It's just astonishing. I've said it before on this programme, but that old maxim by Leslie Orgel, very famous evolutionary biologist and chemist, who said that evolution is cleverer than you. I'd like to add a modifier to that, which is evolution's much sneakier than you as well. Anyway, look, we've got a few more in the next programme, even more bizarre ways that organisms can reproduce. But one that didn't make it to the final cut of the next programme, but I feel obliged to introduce you to, it's a sea slug, which is a hermaphrodite. So it's each organism has both male and female reproductive parts that author and biologist Karen Bondar told me about. And the reason it's amazing and possibly the reason it's not going to be broadcast on Radio 4 and is only for podcast listeners is because this sea slug has a disposable penis.
Each and every time that this particular species functions as a male, as a sexual partner, the penis comes off. It has about 20 regenerations before the male is done. The function of doing that is to, of course, give out the sperm that's in that part of the penis. And what it can also do when it's actually stuck in the female, and I do say female in quotes here because we are talking hermaphrodites, if the male can just drop that part of the penis and step away, the female is actually going to be plugged up, if you will, for a little bit longer. And the function of this plugging is literally that. It will prevent other males from getting their penises into where they want them to be during that interval. And so that could be a potential reason why such a structure has evolved. A male can just drop off his penis at different female partners in order to increase the amount of successful transfer of genetic material.
Yeah, would it be okay if I just didn't say anything at this point?
You know, and here's the thing. These structures are so near and dear to male mammals. And I love when we sort of really begin to step away from what we are expecting to see. Because as humans, we tend to expect that all the other animals on the earth with us do similar things to us. They have eyes and faces and hands and penises and things like that. But to be perfectly honest, it's not the way it is. Most animals have this one biological mandate, and that is to make sure their genetic code gets represented later. And there's a lot of ways that we can make that happen. And if it means, you know, undoing your penis and throwing it across the field and hoping for the best, well, so be it.
I can't think why Michelle Martin thought that was not appropriate for lunchtime on Radio 4.
This is biology. This is just nature.
It's real stuff, right?
You can imagine David Attenborough describing that on...
Can you?
Blue Planet, maybe?
Maybe.
No, maybe not using those exact...
Moving swiftly on. Right. Okay. It's time for...
Rutherford and Fry's Curio of the Week.
I am never going to not find that funny.
No, Curio Jeff Perkins, again, we salute you for sending out that amazing jingle. So, Curio of the Week, in the last series, series 8,
absolutely.
We had the Taste Programme.
Indeed, in which we asked you to send in photographs of your own tongues covered in blue food colouring.
Well, actually, we need to be specific about this because I asked the listeners to send in pictures of their tongues covered in blue food colouring so we could see their spongiform papillae.
I wasn't so keen. But it turns out, actually, one of them is very cute.
Well, I have them here. So the first one was sent in by Peter Fraser, and this is his daughter, Poppy, age 3, who's making the most brilliant face.
It's so sweet. It's so sweet. She's got her eyes closed and her tongue sort of poking out, and she's got a little bit of blue food colouring, like, basically on her chin, and she's got, you can see all of her little, what's the word, Adam? Papillae.
Fungiform papillae. I just called them spongiform papillae, but they're actually fungiform papillae.
It's very, very cute.
And this one is Isabel, who's not a child, but you can't tell from that picture.
Isabel, actually, she wrote in and she said, I'm still not sure if I'm a super taster, but now I look like a total weirdo and need to spend a long time scrubbing my tongue, teeth and lips before I collect my four-year-old from school. She goes on to ask, can blue food colouring make adults hyperactive? And you've got a lot to do. It might be quite useful.
Right, well, there's a question for Series 10. Isabel, we'll get straight onto that. We won't get straight onto it. But the best one, look, the best one here comes from Emma Smith, who is wife of, it says on my notes, wife of Robert Smith, not from The Cure.
That's useful to know. Useful distinction.
Specific information there. That is the quality of information that we've come to expect from our producer, Michelle. That she tells us which 80s goth bands the photos are not sent in by the spouses of. But have a look at the fungiform papilla on that.
Okay, so this looks like it deserves to be on Instagram. It's got, you know, great soft focus on the background. It's beautiful.
Let me read the email that Robert Smith, not from The Cure, and Emma, whose tongue we're looking at, sent from Sydney, a Curios Down Under. He says, Dear Hannah and Adam, after listening to your dreadful vegetables...
All right, Robert, rude.
God, a bit rude.
What's dreadful about that? Was it our podcast?
My phrasing wasn't quite right there. After listening to your Dreadful Vegetables podcast, my wife and I decided to dye our tongues blue to settle a long-running dispute. I maintain she has the diet of a 5-year-old by choice. She has been convinced that she is a super taster, that her diet is perfectly appropriate for a 47-year-old, and she has a complete lack of accountability for her steak, roast potato, cream egg habit. That is an expensive habit. My 7-year-old now believes we are both insane blue-tongued vampires. It has been an interesting evening.
I believe the attached image demonstrates that my wife is not a super taster and that I can force her to eat broccoli with a clean conscience. I think Rob's general advice is don't force people to do anything.
No, I don't think you can force her to eat broccoli. However, both of us would like to state for your 7-year-old's information that your parents are both insane blue-tongued vampires.
Fact.
Well
done to all of those people who sent in their lovely pictures of the blue tongue. A hypothetical badge is imaginarily winging its way to you and will be on your doorstep and not in your hand very soon.
In your imaginary doorstep in Sydney. That's Robert Smith and Emma Smith, both vampires from The Cure. All right, so you are our Curios of the Week. Yay!
We will see you next time when we'll be talking more sex.
This is the BBC.
Hello, all you curious people. I'm Jim Akilili, and I just want to remind you that all the scientists on these curious cases don't just exist to answer your questions. They're people. They have lives too. For the past 7 years, I've made it my business to find out about the life scientific. What makes someone want to become a world authority on fungi sex or quantum gravity? And I've cross-examined many of the experts on these curious cases. So if you want to find out who these people are and what they do, you might like to give the Life Scientific podcast a listen. See what you think.